So, there are three worlds, and there's only three in all the blim-blam universe. I'll tell you what they are. There's the world that you're in now, the things you've surrounded yourself with, physically, mentally, the personnel of your life. I know that's a cold term. There's what you left behind to get to where you are. That comprises a world of its own, whether it's learning experiences that have taught you lessons that have helped you move forward, or whether it's actually people and friends and places, all the way down to materials and devices that are gone from your life or too far away to be reached. And finally, it's the world that you don't know about. There's the thing that's around the corner. It could be a monster with claws, or it could be a smiling friend. Most of the time, we're in here and now world mode. We negotiate what we have, and perhaps the best of us, at times when we're reflective enough, when we're thoughtful enough, can keep in mind the road markers from behind, the path that we took to get to where we are, and use that as guideposts for where we want to be or would like to be. I think when you face a lot of the stringent aspects of where we are, and you look at their composition, you'll find that it's a meaty amalgam. It's nothing so neatly laced. It's something that a kid pushed together like clay, because we can't do fine precision operations with our lives. At best, we have these moments of precision amidst a large sea of approximation. And that's what carries us forward. The moments of precision perhaps lend us some clarity, those epiphanies which we get. But it's those big lumps of clay of different colors pushed together and smooshed together and all swirling within each other. That's what we can really make. That's our skill level, so to speak, because we can't really get, and probably don't really want, the kind of surgical clarity that would let somebody suddenly morph into a Vulcan and look at it all with logic, because that's not the way to live. Perhaps the way to get to the unknown universe of the future is to more and more accept the fact that there will be gaps in your reasoning, gaps in your logic, that the more you know, the less you know, and that every little tidbit that you file away in your brain, something gets bumped off the cliff. So do we live on the land or the abyss? Do we try to recall these things? Suddenly deja vu comes in, something we haven't thought of in years. Or we're lying right on the fringe of sleep, and a memory comes unbidden that hadn't entered our minds since we were kids. Are those auguries? Are those little signposts and omens that try to tell us something? That get interpreted through the wavelengths of dreams and become themselves animated creatures within the soulscape of what we live. Some call them demons, you see. It's as good a name as any, because when things resurface, depending on how you dwell on things, depending on the life that you've had, and the regrets, and the things that you kick yourself for, and how hard you are on yourself, they may very well manifest in a form that could best be called demons. And when they come to visit you in your present world, they are not strictly ghosts of the past. They are not limited to one other world. They are like that amalgam, that mushing together of clay, remnants of the past, a little bit of where you are so you can relate better, and then the unknown element of the future, a visitation upon you of thoughts which could be uneasy, thoughts which you do not know how to classify right away, And it's that mis-ease of classification, that thing that takes us time to figure out, that we're very leery about, that we approach with sometimes caution, sometimes disdain, and mistrust. We are, by nature, mistrustful. Now that comes from pain. That's rooted in the past, clearly. We cannot predict that we will be done wrong in the future, so we have no reason to mistrust any specific instance in the future, which is why pitfalls arise and you can walk right into them. However, when they slip past that threshold and they become part of the past, then they can be the signposts and warnings which scream in your mind. Is their screaming relevant and useful for the most part? Or are they preventing you from taking steps on a path that might prove to be the most rewarding? I think if you look at what really would be a list, if you had to comprise one, if you have the time on a lazy Sunday afternoon, and there was not much interesting in the paper, more news of death and disaster, you're already done the crossword, and you sit and you comprise a list, call it signposts, road marks, those things. Now, just today, Heather put up a blog of the five most important moments, what are they, of your life. Well, these don't necessarily have to be moments of great import. These could be little things which just leave some questions, little things which are not resolved and haunt and come back and have a life of their own that sort of springs up like a ghost of fog out of the grounds and moors of our thoughts. If we can try to have a seance with them, if we can try to tune out the present, that current world that surrounds us with the blaring horns and the yapping and the demands and the televisions and everybody trying to get you to buy something. If we can let that fade, something else becomes clearer. There is never true silence. In the universe, you could think, dead silent, hear a pin drop. That's your range, perhaps, but there is never true silence. There is always something. And being attuned to your own past, the world that you left behind, could be the guide marker, just a little bit. It can't be anything more than a little bit, for where you might go.